All right, welcome everybody. You are in the Documentary Filmmaker Roundtable, the Art of Nonfiction Filmmaking. I'm actually not Jim Adams. Jim actually had some trouble and couldn't be here, so Kevin asked me to fill in, so I will be panelist slash moderator today. So first of all, I'm gonna start at the far end, and we're gonna introduce ourselves all the way down here. So let's start.
I wasn't supposed to be on this one, so if I'm on the list, don't worry about it. I'm just kind of hanging out. My name is Andre LaMont. I'm a filmmaker, but over the last 8 years or so, I've been working on documentaries. Interesting enough, I worked on two before, one with PBS on influenza, and I worked on one where I was shooting it as a, I guess we call it a cinematographer. I don't call myself a DP, but they didn't have any equipment, they didn't have any money, so I was able to shoot. We did some pretty cool interviews with some big name people, so I said, yeah, I'm in. And so I shot on that one. Now I'm working on about four documentaries at one time. It's kind of a weird thing to say, but if you look at them, they all kind of connect. So I've been doing a lot of documentary work lately, so I'll get around. That's pretty much about it, and I'll pass along the rest to the other experts down here.
Well, my name is Bob Wells, and the project we worked on was Mystery of the Trees, which you'll hear more about from Don. I've been doing this for almost 40 years now. It was all film when I started. And I got used to cutting pieces, and bins weren't a thing on the computer. They were satchels that you put the film in to keep it from getting dirty. But anyway, the equipment is what's enabled documentary for me, because the cost of it has come way, way down. And so now we can tell stories that we couldn't tell in the old days when film cost so much.
Okay, I'm Don Wells. We've been working together for many years. We're no kin of. We have yet to find out how we're related, but we both got the same last name. I'm the president of the Mountain Stewards, which is a nonprofit 501c3 organization here in Georgia, and we were primarily put together in 2003 to build hiking trails and recreational facilities in North Georgia, and we started finding these curiously bent trees, which led us to find Bob, and we then decided, with Bob's urging in 2006, to film it. And off we took, and it's been going ever since. My wife Diane and I are the co-producers of the film, but the Mountain Stewards was the one that put it out.
I'm Denise Carey-Costa. I'm an author, a journalist, a documentary filmmaker, an animal advocate, and an advocate for human rights. My film, Tony's Tale, Tragedy in Arizona, played this morning at 11 a.m. And I'm very happy to be here to meet fellow filmmakers and see their work as well. I'm currently working on a new film on the history of Hollywood, from the silent era to the inception of television. And that will be filmed later this summer, at the end of August.
Wonderful, excellent. My name is Daniel Espeut. I'm the CEO of Espeut Productions, which is a proud sponsor of this year's Gwinnett Center International Film Festival. At the first annual Gwinnett Center International Film Festival, I had the world premiere of my documentary feature debut, which was called Grease Paint. It won the Audience Choice Award for Best Feature Film that year. Got to be a judge for this film festival the second year, and now we are back with a documentary short called Raised in the South of Normal, which is screening today at 5, as well as a music video for the band that performed at the opening night reception, Playground Heroes, Don't Be Judging Me. That'll also be screening at 5 o'clock, but I suggest you go to Raised in the South of Normal because you can find the music video online publicly. And I'm happy to be on this panel as well as the moderator, and I'm very happy to be amongst these very talented people up here. So let's start off by asking you folks out there, how many of you have produced a documentary, whether it's in this festival or not? Okay, good. So I'm assuming the rest of you probably just have an interest in maybe producing a documentary, or maybe have a story, or just curious, or you're looking for something to do before a screening happens, like an hour from now, right? Something like that? Just fans? Okay, that's wonderful. So I'm gonna open this Okay. So I'm going to open this question to the panel, because we're talking about nonfiction here, all right? I always felt like when I got into the filmmaking world, I always thought I was going to, you know, get into maybe screenwriting or get some scripts, and I was gonna produce fiction. I was going to get into having full control over a story, partially because you know that's what we're used to seeing in the movie theaters, and also the fact that I got a C in my directing the documentary class when I went to SCAD. So I didn't think I was gonna come out doing a documentary right out the gate. So with that being said, that's what ended up happening, and I realized, you know what, real life can be very entertaining still. So let me open this up to the panel here. How do you make real life entertaining?
I think you pay attention to it. You let it present itself because it's full of surprises. You think you're shooting one thing and something else happens. And often you don't discover it until you're back in the editing room, and you start looking at things, and you learn things that maybe you got by you the first time. We learned things from Native Americans that we didn't have a clue what they meant until we began to discover more of the meaning.
I think maybe adding to that a little bit is that when we first started shooting, we didn't have a title. We didn't have a script. We shot film of Native American and other people who wanted to tell the story. And we opened it up, and as Bob was talking about, that they really started opening up to us a lot as we expanded our relationships with the Native Americans. And had we written a script to start with, we would have never got the story we got. We shot 100 hours of film, digital film, and out of that came the 1 hour of what we have. We have a lot left in the can right now. But it was interesting, and as we went different places around the country, we learned more, which opened up the door to go somewhere else, that we had to keep going. And we're not stopped. We're going out again, and we're going to continue doing the story. It's a big story, and we finally found Native Americans who would tell us that story. It, a lot of what is in this story is secret, and they would never talk to people about it. But they felt like we were not trying to exploit them, and so they were willing to open up and to begin to tell the story, and they felt like what we were doing was great for them, so that's where they went.
And we tried to check that out. One of our first interviews that opened new material was with a gentleman named Tom Belt, who's a professor of Cherokee language at Western Carolina. And he told us things that we had not heard before. And what we were doing with this was we'd come back and we'd edit a small segment. Don and Diane have been doing public presentations where these segments would have sort of appeared. But we went back to Tom with an edited piece and said, did we get it right? Because we weren't sure. And so we had that verification. And in fact, when we showed him the piece, he said, we've been trying to say that for 200 years. Even internally to the tribe.
That's fascinating. And so, and I didn't get a chance to see yours, but I mean, I can tell there was, you know, obviously some involvement with some nature. And I mean, now that I'm hearing, you know, this about sort of a little bit of history elements there. Now that's obviously one sort of subject matter that we find in documentaries. And, you know, Denise, I got to catch the last half of yours, which had to do with the pit bull that was put down by a court order in Arizona for allegedly attacking a neighbor that was down the street. And so obviously we have some appeal there for animal lovers. When we're talking about, sometimes when I say entertaining, that doesn't necessarily mean, you know, we're gonna make our audience, you know, laugh. We might wanna make them cry. We might wanna make them think. So how did you try to tie that in, not just to the animal lovers, but to, you know, just the general public.
Well, I think everyone can relate to Tony's tale, whether you're a dog lover, an advocate for pit bulls, or a person who is an advocate for people that are the victims of injustice or judicial injustice. So I think Tony's tale will strike a chord with anyone who watches it, especially, like I said, those who are fans or advocates for humans and animals. It also tugs the heartstrings. A lot of people walk out of the theater saying, how on earth could that happen here in America when we have a judicial system that's supposed to be objective and not judgmental? I heard of the case, when I first heard of the case, through a petition site on for Michelle and Heather, was their dog that was euthanized. I heard about that and I knew it was wrong, and I saw the picture and I heard the story and I knew it just didn't add up. So I started out by writing a news column on my website on theexaminer.com about the case. And from that I developed the book version of the story, and then from then I decided to produce the documentary film. I think documentaries are great because everyone out there has a story, and every story is unique. And if you can capture the essence of each person's story and the heart and the feelings, you're educating as well as entertaining. And that's what we set out to do with Tony's Tale.
Andre, talk about subject matter in the documentaries that you've been working on. I'm not familiar, so sort of let some people know, like, what are some projects that you've worked on, what are you currently working on? Are you working on any sort of personal people, like personal stories or anything like that?
Well, my documentary, my plight was by accident. I contemplated doing something on Dr. King, because every time they talk about him, they only start at Morehouse. And it was never any conversation what happened beforehand. He happened to have gone to high school here in Atlanta. And I thought that was interesting that it had to play a role in his upbringing some kind of way. I mean, because high school seemed to have meant more back then than it means now, because we have a high school dropout problem. It's enormous, huge, and embarrassing, actually. And Georgia's like third from the bottom of the list or something. It's ridiculous. So I went to a career day, and someone told me to look at the archives in the room. I said, archives? Had archives here? And so I went in and I saw these people that went there, and I saw, when I saw the mother of a friend of mine I went to college with, film school with, and his mother went to the school, and I said, his mother went to this school? My mother went to this school. And so I started looking around and found information. Yeah, it was true. I said, if I didn't know this, what else did I not know? And I started to realize I had been a part of something that was historic, and it was never really explained. It was never explained. And when I thought about it from a film perspective, going to film school, I know, Daniel, you and I talked about it, that, you know, SCAD kind of covers documentary filmmaking. There's not many programs in Georgia that cover documentary filmmaking. It's just not really discussed at where I went to school at the time when I went to Clark. I went to Clark and I went to Georgia State, and I never remember anybody saying, hey, let's do documentaries. You know, most of the time it's like, they don't make any money, they're boring or whatever, they're long-winded or whatever. So it was never explained, and I never talked much about it until I end up on one and shooting another. And I did one with TBN, actually. TBN, Trinity Broadcasting Network, did one. I actually worked on that. I don't have like 4 or 5 positions on that, but I worked in the Atlanta station, and they came out of California, and they did one on the art of healing or something like that. They let her change the name. And I started to really think about it more and how interesting it was, and I kind of learned from there. And I said, So when that came about, I saw this story at my own high school, and I started to find all these people that went to the school. I said, why did no one ever tell us about this? You know, I'm not an author, and so writing a book was obviously a thing need to be done, still needs to be done. But I'm more of a filmmaker. I mean, I started in film too. I mean, so when I thought about trying to find a camera and trying to put a crew together, I never forget this woman came to me. She's Navi Harris, the school is named after her in DeKalb County, and she cursed me out. She said, damn fool, just get a camera and start shooting because people are dying on you. Don't you see that? And I started to think about it, and I said, you know, people are dying. So the problem that I run into and I have, when you're doing historical documentary of the nature I'm doing, I'm losing people. I'm losing them, and if I can't keep up, you know, I lose that valuable person. Then I gotta go find someone else for my understanding. I try to find the next person that could be as vibrant as them. You know, so if I couldn't find Dr. King, I got his sister. You know, I can't get Spike Lee's mother, so I get Spike Lee. You follow me? And so, lucky I got a Tuskegee Airman. I'm fortunate enough to get him. I can't get Nipsey Russell, so I get Bruce Bruce. You know, so these are some of the names I've gone. George Bush even came to the school, so I'm after George Bush. You guys got any connections? Give me a call. So, you know, it's a situation to where I kind of found myself in this historical documentary and really never having documentary training or having worked with any of the legends of documentary production. So I've kind of had to do it with my film experience, but I will say, to me, it's different. It's fun. I love it because I get a chance to meet and talk to these people. I did Andy Young last weekend, Shirley Franklin the week before that, mayors, as you know. And to get a chance to talk to some of these people, it's actually kind of invigorating. And it's fun. I met someone, I'm not going to call the name, big time producer here in town. And I said, hey, you guys are doing all these productions, all types of productions. You ever thought about documentaries? Oh, they don't make any money. I couldn't argue, but he said it so quick. And about a year later, I saw him and said, guess what I'm doing? I'm doing a documentary. Well, he didn't call me. So, you know, but, you know, I think it's a point in time where if I had to do it all over again, and I like that SCAD is doing that I think documentaries need to be looked at more because Atlanta is a city, and, of course, Georgia the state, where we have overlooked a lot of stories that are right here underneath our nose that need to be told. I mean, there's just so much history here, and all we ever talk about is the same old thing, the Dr. King, the flag, and I mean, we're on that stuff. It's other stories that need to be told here. They just need to be told, and that people have done great things that have been overlooked. And you can't always get money together and do a movie, feature film, even though you can do it here now, but we talked about it the last panel. It's hard to get it done, but documentaries, and like we're saying, the equipment now and the cost has come down. I mean, you get you a good documentary camera for less than 10 grand. You really can. I mean, you know, and if you shoot it right, light it right, it looks good. So I kind of looked up in this thing, and so mine is historical in nature. And so when I interview one person by accident, I end up telling that person's story. And I lost that person 2 years ago. I didn't even know they were gone. And so, you know, it's kind of by accident that I started doing it because these stories have not been told in my circle, you know. So my subject matter is historical, and I think it'll be entertaining because I got people right here saying, oh, are you sure? Yes, I'm sure. You just didn't know, and no one ever told you, and no one ever told me. So I'm just doing it because I guess I feel that it needs to be done, and, you know, that's how I got involved with this thing, and that's where my story is going.
Okay, so you've touched on a lot of good things, and there's a lot of questions that I've sort of come up with, and I want to make sure that we try to cover a lot of the important ones and, of course, give a chance for the audience to chime in at the end for any questions that you might have. So you talked about the stumbling onto the story, and I think being in documentary filmmaking, that happens more often than not. You sort of stumble onto a story, especially if it's having something to do with a current event versus something that is historical but it hasn't been done before, and you said, well, you know what, if you know, why am I going to wait for someone else to tell the story when I've got the idea, I've got the vision, right? Touching on to what you were saying, Andre, about all the great stories that are here in Georgia, that's sort of what sparked us to do Grease Paint, which is about a clown circus that's based out of Dallas, Georgia, which is about 30 minutes west of Marietta. And one of the interesting things was to tie to that, going to trying to make it interesting and make it relatable, was there was a niche of a lot of people that were in the clowning world in the entertainment industry. So two things we had to do with that was we had to provide some historical references to some professional circus performers and clowns in general to be interspersed amongst our underlying narrative, which was Joey's and his family's journey up and down the East Coast trying to make a living doing this business, and it sort of cuts across a lot of boundaries with entertainers alike, not just clowns, but musicians, magicians, because we're all looking for the same thing. We're all trying to get that want from an audience, and with our documentary short, Raising the South of Normal, you know, that's just a good old-fashioned, you know, southern story of a woman named Loretta Hannon who grew up in a poor part of Georgia and just sort of figured out a way to deal with her upbringing and laugh about it, which of course probably maybe a little bit more relatable than something that's more niche-oriented. But again, it goes to the point of trying to make it interesting to the general public. I always think, and it's something that a lot of documentary filmmakers, I think, sometimes get lost in making the fan film versus making the film that preaches to the unconverted.
Hey, Dan, can I say something? I had a conversation earlier with Troy, who was on the panel earlier, and I didn't even know today that they showed the Dante's Down the Hatch documentary. If you guys have not seen that, you need to see it. If you love jazz, you really need to see that documentary. I mean, I stood in line at the Atlanta Film Festival. I snuck in, actually. But they had a line, and it was so popular, they had to show it again. That is a wonderful documentary, and the story is that the employee who had been there for like 13 years or so, when they got ready to close the place down, they got the notice, he tried to find a documentary filmmaker to do it for him, and he couldn't. And so he ended up doing it. Never did a documentary before. He was an actual employee. I saw the documentary. It's wonderful because I'm in jazz. I love jazz. I worked at WCLK for 7 years. So jazz is part of my makeup. I always say jazz taught me how to be a filmmaker because jazz makes you understand the music. You just can't jump up and play jazz on the radio station. You got to understand it. So the same thing with film keeps you honest. You can't see it till it comes out. You don't know what it looks like. It's almost like how we got here. You know, digital is like microwave, film is like the oven. So what I'm saying is that you need to see that documentary because he said he took it to Macon to the film festival and nobody showed up. But in Atlanta, that's a huge place. Dante's Down the Hatch. It was right here at the festival. I didn't even know about it, but I encourage you to look at it because that's a true part of Atlanta history. Back in underground Atlanta, they were like the focal point down there, back when underground Atlanta was underground Atlanta. So I just thought that's another story that when I saw it, I was like, man, I'm so glad someone told this story. And so it's tons of story. You want to be a filmmaker? Be a documentary filmmaker. You can't go wrong.
Now I have a question that I was very curious to hear what the panel has to say about this, because I'm a documentary filmmaker who tries to avoid narration when I can. In some situations, you almost need it. But to me, I always like to have my subjects tell the story, and maybe that's just because I've been doing documentaries about people that are talking about their lives and their journeys. So let's talk a little bit about, and I want to hear this panel talk about, sort of the use of narration. When is it appropriate? When is it not appropriate? When does it make your documentary feel more like the news or versus something that is more theatrical and something that, you know, someone would pay a ticket to go see to be informed or to put it in their queue in their Netflix? Let me start with you, please.
I think the narrative should just support the documentary. I don't think it should be the entire documentary. I think a narrative that is interesting to listen to is told with inflection and emotion, but is interspersed then with live interviews with the actual subjects or people that knew the subjects. I think all that blended together will make a good film. I think you have too much of one or not enough of the other. Your documentary may become just like talking heads or may look stagnant. So I think by interspersing the two, if you can craft it well enough, you can be very successful with it.
We did use a narrator, a gentleman by the name of Wes Studi. Wes is a very well-known actor, and he does great voiceover work as well. But his personal life story mirrored the story we were trying to tell. And so he becomes our film becomes his story, almost, the way we've structured it. So he's more than the narrator, he provides the transitions that we couldn't make any other way. He explains some of the chronology that makes it make sense. But he brings authenticity to it because he's full-blood Cherokee whose life mirrored the life that, or the events of the loss of culture that we're trying to bring forward.
So was that sort of was that like a happy accident? Was it planned that way?
It was, we were trying to get this story told as widely as we could. And so the idea initially was, let's see if we can find a Native American who could serve this role. And then I ran into a filmmaker here in Atlanta who had worked with him. And we thought maybe we'd have a little in with him. We found out the agents are like gatekeepers. It's very tough to get to the actual person. We filmed in green screen in Santa Fe because we didn't have the budget to bring him here on location. And then when all was said and done, we were going to use a guy who'd given us a freebie narration, a professional narrator here in Georgia that I'd used for years in projects. He was going to be the voice of the Mountain Stewart side, and Wes was going to be the voice of Native America. We showed that to some folks who I respect their opinion on greatly, and they said, no, you need Wes for the whole thing. Too many voices otherwise, no continuity. So we went back to Wes and said, we need you to do the voiceover as well. It was just simply a matter of taking the script and taking it from third person, putting it in first person. And we made it work that way. But we had to do that long distance to Santa Fe. We put it back in the same room where we had filmed the green screen. We hired a student at the Santa Fe equivalent of SCAD. And they did the recording using the same kind of equipment we had recorded before, so we could get a similar soundtrack.
Can I ask a question? Why were people saying that it wouldn't work when you decided to go with the other voice?
If we had decided to go with the other voice?
Well, they were saying both, you had two voices, two narrations, right?
That was the original script.
And they said stick with one, right?
Yeah, I was advised, I said, kill the cat. Kill the kitty. The kitty being my famous, filmmaker's preference.
Oh.
I said, no, that's your own pet idea. You need to get rid of that. They were right. I think it would have been more complicated. It would have made it a two-person story rather than highlighting the Native American.
I say that because some people are just not willing to compromise, and sometimes you've got to be willing to compromise. You may be a lunch or a charge. To me, this is part of the process, is to give a little, take a little bit, I guess.
It's a filmmaking is not a solo operation. It really takes input from lots of people. We talked about the music. We were very fortunate. One of the people we ran into along the way was a guy named Charlie Wayne Watson. Choctaw heritage, who plays Native American flute. So he said, how would you like to be the sound person for our film? He said, sure. So he had like 12 CDs of material, and we were able to find things that matched as we went through. He's now releasing the soundtrack as a separate CD for Project itself.
That comes in handy. A little extra things that go along with the film, obviously, there to perpetuate that. It was something that Andre, you posed a good question, and of course, yeah, about killing the cat. Sometimes people say, the baby. We all have these ways that we and we want to present the story, and then sometimes we get it into the hands of junkie public or distributors or what have you, and then they say, well, you need to cut this, you need to do this, you need to do that. I'll tell my little personal story, and then I want to find out some of the challenges that you all face. Greasepaint, when it premiered here, it was a 2-hour cut, and it was only shown at this one at a film festival in Louisville, and after that I was realizing from programmers that they said, well, if you want, you're a first-time filmmaker, you don't have any names in it, you know, you really need to try to get this thing down below 90 minutes if you're even going to attempt to do anything with it anywhere. And I came down to find out that our distributor said, yeah, it's a good thing that you did that too, because we would have told you the same exact thing. So we went through, we scrutinized it. The first 10 minutes was actually sort of easy to cut out because it was like, I got tired of it. Then the next 10 minutes were, you know, I guess, I understand. And then the next 5 minutes or whatever it was, I was literally just trimming frames because I couldn't cut anymore. We finally got it down to 84 minutes, and that was sort of the big, you know, just, you know, tough part as a filmmaker to say, okay, I get it, I understand, I know I need to do this in order to make it work better for the audience. Because one of the things is, you know, when we're making these stories, as I saw a great little documentary about George Lucas versus his fans, you know, the fans really felt like, you know, when you made Star Wars and you made this for us, you know, it's now ours, it's partially ours. So if you try to change things up on us when you made episodes 1 through 3 and all this other stuff, you know, we're gonna get upset. And it's interesting to think about it that way, because we're making it.
So the Empire struck back?
The Empire did strike back, and pretty harshly, actually. So let me ask the panelists here, what were some of the killing the cat moments? We obviously heard a little bit from you guys. What were some of the killing the cat moments? Whether it was, had to change up some music, had to rearrange a few things, maybe just had to cut it shorter, cut it longer, or some things?
A lot of the things we faced with Tony's Tales, we did a lot of exterior shots, and then when we went to edit it, we had what we thought were a lot of really great moments on film. But when we went to the editing room, we realized that there was background noise at the playground where we filmed. So we had to cut that. We had a very moving reading of The Rainbow Bridge by a young girl, which talks about when a pet dies. We had to cut that due to the wind. It was blowing a lot behind her, and then the lighting wasn't good. We had a very good scene with Michelle Dozier, Tony's owner, where she talked about the last day when they went to see Tony at the kennel, knowing that he was going to be euthanized, and said their goodbyes. It was a very, very emotional scene. In fact, those of us on the crew that were filming got very teary-eyed just hearing her presentation. And she, of course, cried, you know, while talking about it. And we thought it was going to be fantastic in the film, but when we got to editing, once again, there were lighting issues, sound issues that we had to cut what we thought was a really golden performance by her. And we were really sad to have to cut it out. Also, when we put the film together, we wanted to keep in mind pacing. We didn't want any parts where it was going to start to lag a little bit. So we wanted to make sure that the movie just kept moving so people wouldn't lose interest or have any like low moments in the film.
Yeah, I know you guys have talked a little bit about that. You guys have any other moments of that?
I might just say that when you shot West Studio, we shot into a strip. When you interview a Native American elder, there's no script. And those interviews are an hour and a half long. And there's nuggets all through it. So the difficulty that the mob has to do is we have to go into those hour and a half of really good stuff and cut it to a minute or 5 minutes or 2 minutes or some pull piece here and another piece over there. So it's a very, very difficult thing. They don't know how to talk in very quick sentences. They want to talk for a long time.
There are no sound bites in oral history.
Now that I've got your attention, I want you to listen. And so you listen. And so it's very, very difficult. That's why we have 100 hours in the can and we have 1 hour in the film. There's a lot more left over.
But it lets you use B-roll to advantage, because you can, these days you can edit all that. The old days it was a pair of scissors and tape, and you couldn't take breaths out and edit. consonants where they were missing. These days you can do that. Do it on an interview. But covering that visually so that it makes sense and adds to the story or even expands it. And a picture still is worth a thousand words. And if you're talking about things in the natural world, I mean, just to show a beautiful documentary shot in Tahiti. The natural world there is gorgeous, guys. You did a fabulous job with that. It's a way of telling the story that pulls people in. It's entertaining as well as educational.
Yeah, Dan, I'll say something on that. I'm in the middle of mine, for those who are in the middle of deciding, I've been instructed to stop. I'm still shooting, but I found the best story recently. So I can't always say, I just have a question, when do you stop? But I took my project and I tried to divide it up instead of making it too long. I look at more marketing now, because obviously marketing feature films are tough, so marketing documentaries are even grueling. So I try to look at more marketing plan with mine. So one, I'm going to separate and tie into a university that has a pretty big name that's also tied into my story. The other one is just going to be the documentary itself, probably more like what I envision. And the third one, I'm taking the actual name of the person on the school, and I'm creating a separate documentary for that person. So I'm gonna spend too much time talking about that person in the documentary because I have so many people to cover. And what I'm hoping is that I can market those kind of separately, but actually they're tied in the same. And in terms of the amount of footage, because I got hours of footage in my interviews, I love my interviews to go an hour or more because, you know, I like to think that I found that some of the people I interview really cover other subject matters. You know, I mean, when you interview great people, usually they cover more than one subject matter. And so I started to find out that now I have little mini documentaries that have come from the interviews with these other people. So when I go to interview now, you know, like I interviewed Deion Sanders, not for one of my documentaries, but then I thought to ask him about Steve Avery. And then I asked John Smoltz about Dion. And so you got these stories of these guys telling these stories. Hopefully they're not stories they tell all the time. So what I would advise you, if you interview somebody who's great, like that group of Atlanta Braves, I mean, they got stories within the stories. And so, you know, you try to find another way to piece another story together. And so now, you know, all these guys are like Hall of Fame guys. And so, you know, now you can pull out and create another product because we got how many cable networks now? I mean, so you have to look at too, how you're gonna market your project as you're doing. And again, I'm in the middle of mine to a certain extent, but I'm trying to consider marketing at the same time with this extra footage that I got left over because maybe I can take the interview with one person and put it in another documentary because I'm sure with yours and Native American, I'm sure nature is discussed a lot. What if that soundbite or that comment can go toward something that deals with nature, and so that's a whole other documentary that probably, so that's how I look at using my extra footage, you know, and so, I mean, again, I'm still in the midst of it, but I'm trying to recreate the wheel, I guess.
Now, I'm gonna sort of combine two questions here because it's gonna segue exactly from what you're talking about, which was when are you finished and deciding what's your format? Because one of the things that we knew with Grease Man automatically that it was definitely a feature, there was enough there to make something over a 90-minute time span. With Race in the South of Normal, because Loretta grew up in the poor part of Georgia, she didn't have a lot of photos, she didn't have a lot of footage. So we found ourselves repurposing some stock footage because she had her dad was a World War II vet. He was one of the liberators at Dachau concentration camp, so there was a lot of great stock footage there we can use to sort of describe his life and how he grew up in contrast to her mother growing up in just poor part of Wrightsville. So my question is, you know, what were sort of some things that made you decide on whether or not you were producing a feature with your project or producing a short? And when did you decide I've got enough to make whatever that decision is, or did it change?
Our project spanned 8 years. When we started, we wanted to do it high def, but that was HDV to start.
Yes.
So it's evolved. Some of the last footage was shot on 4K. But this idea that Indians bent trees is controversial. There are still people, professors at universities, who say it's a fraud. They never did. So our initial documentary was Mystery of the Trees. Did they do it? And that was sort of a scientific thing. It involved dendrochronology. It involved GPS mapping that was not available. So after the first year, we had pretty well answered the initial mystery, and we could have stopped then. But that's when we started talking to elders. And it became very clear that we didn't know everything we were talking about. We kind of thought we did, but we didn't.
And right there, I just want to sort of point that out, that is something that happens a lot in documentary filmmaking, where you start out with one thing, and then through your sort of learning your subject, because one of the things about documentary filmmaking is you have to become an expert in the subject matter you're talking about. It's almost like education you never thought you were going to get. But then in the middle of it, or even in the beginning stages, you start to find out there's more to it. So that right there and I'm glad you shared, that's a great example of sort of it almost evolving into a greater story.
So the next 7 years, we would do an interview, and it would have a seed in it that would lead us to somebody else. That would lead us to somebody else. And then we finally ended up back with the Utes for a second time in Colorado with a gentleman, James Jefferson, Dr. James Jefferson. He holds a PhD in history. He's a very, very smart man, and he's dedicated to taking youth from the Ute Nation and connecting them with their cultural history. And they have a conference in Colorado. The third one will occur this summer. Don and I leave Thursday to go to it. But when he started telling us that the mystery was, even for him, was more than he could ever know. That sort of put some closure to it. So we started with one mystery, and it blew it up.
Interesting. Good. Now, you're going to add some.
Let me just add one thing to that is that we had finished shooting probably around 2013. And we had a segment that we wanted to end it with, which were out of the Cherokees. We were going to use it. And they came back to us and said, there's some things there maybe we don't want you to do. And so what we had to do is throw out the entire segment from the Cherokees that we had shot, which left us with a hole. And that was filled with the Utes. But we didn't get to shoot that until August of 2014. So that's the problem you face when you're doing this. You're struggling to get their story together, and then you gotta make sure, have I got it all? And I don't, and then I gotta go find the rest of it. So we had to search who we were gonna go to, and then we were led to Dr. James Jefferson, who said, yes, I would be happy to do this.
Okay. And since I segued off of you, Andre, I'm gonna let you wrap up if there's anything other on this subject, but I wanted to ask Denise, since you had a court case linked to your story, and of course, obviously talking about sort of presenting the other side of the coin, if you will, and then maybe the aftermath, tell us a little bit about how you figured out, you know, where were you going to be sort of finished with the story, and sort of maybe even leave it for someone to explore further into the situation. Tell me about that.
Right. Well, I kind of had a running start on the film, because I didn't have to start the film from scratch, from like trying to come together with a script and an idea and how to piece it together, because I had written a book, Tony's Tale, Tragedy in Arizona, in 2012. It was published. So I kind of had an outline of how I wanted to tell the story on film. So I used the book as the treatment for the film. I embellished, added more to the film as far as the dog behaviorist, the history of the pit bull that I did not put in the film. And I kind of left the ending for the audience to decide, the closing scene where Michelle says it could have been a dog, or not a dog, a coyote, a bird of prey that could have attacked the small dog. There was no evidence that linked her dogs to the death of the small dog. So I kind of wanted to leave it open-ended for the audience so they could make their own determination. Was it Michelle's dog, or was there enough evidence to sustain the fact that where they lived, a wild animal could have been the one to have killed the small dog? Since no one knows, there was no eyewitness, we can't prove it either way. So I want to leave it up to the audience to determine based on what they saw in the film.
Yeah, Andre, do you have anything to add about
that? It's looking like a documentary.
Because I actually have a great segue, but I want to make sure we cover everything as well.
I want to tie in with both Don and Bob and I said, is that he said, I was talking to C.T. Vivian, you guys know it is a civil rights guy in town, he's very legend. And I was talking to him, he said, you know, you need to write a book. I said, well, I'm in the middle of this documentary and I don't write books. He said, yeah, but you need to write a book. And he actually gave me an idea for a book. And he said, not only would you, should you do it, but it might help you with your promotion and help get it out there. So the combination of the book and the documentary is obviously an interesting combination if you can make it happen. Because like Bob and Don, I've been doing this now 8 years too. And listening to them sound like me, just when you think you got all of it, then someone else pops up and like, oh my God. Because last year, a year ago this month, I found the most intriguing story of everybody over the last 8 years. And now, I had to stop the main project and do that person. Because that person is part of a living history. And you know what next year is, right? 20-year anniversary for the Atlanta Games. And so this person was pivotal in the Atlanta Games. I never knew about this person, nothing about him, no less they were tied to my project. So I've now had to drop the major part of it to focus on this person, because if I get this done, maybe we're gonna promote the other half of it to show. Because I have one participant who was in my documentary who just recently died. Allie Pat was a couple weeks ago, he died. And Allie Pat's documentary alone won the Atlanta Film Festival Audience Award and then won the Bronze Next Film Festival Award. So, you know, I mean, that's just one guy in my project. So how do I harness that one guy, stick him amongst others, and make this thing just as successful as the project on Allie Pat? And oddly enough, on the Allie Pat documentary, I think Tom was talking, you guys know Tom, about he had problems with the music and the music rights, and so that's a whole nother ball game, you know. And shooting on, he had problems shooting on 4.3 or so as opposed to 16x9. So there's a lot of issues that, you know, you have to consider, which is interesting what Bob and Don were talking about, the different footage and cameras that they use, you know, because that becomes a nightmare. And then when I started, I was shooting on mini DV tape. Now it's like cars, so it's weird.
Yeah. Now, I have one last question. I'm going to try to, in respect of time, I want to make sure that we open it up to the audience. But I am going to coin a phrase that, thankfully, I've got to see Andre do a lot of moderating. This is my first time moderating the panel, so I hope I've been doing okay for you guys. The elephant in the room when it comes to documentaries, okay? Thankfully, because of a few filmmakers, you know, documentaries about maybe 10 to 15 years ago became popular, and all of a sudden it became something that, you know, people were interested in. More documentaries were getting theatrical releases, they were getting out there. You know, thankfully, you know, for a while the Oscars were showing love to documentaries, and one of my favorite documentarians is Errol Morris. Thin Blue Line, Unknown Known, Standard Operating Procedure, sort of refashioned the teleprompter to cause the subjects to look directly into the lens without feeling like they're looking directly into the lens. A lot of innovative stuff. However, we all know some people known as Michael Moore and Morgan Spurlock, right? We've heard of those folks, right? thanks to, you know, in my opinion, thanks to, you know, Supersize Me and, of course, the slew of Michael Moore films, documentaries became something that people would actually go to the theater to see. Now, elephant in the room, right? You mentioned leaving it up to the audience, right? There's that form of being a documentarian, telling the story, presenting two sides of the coin, and letting the audience decide. Then you have the propaganda film, right? Which actually has been around for much longer than recently, because a lot of times films in its early days were used as propaganda films by governments from different countries and that type of thing. What are your stances on the propaganda versus let the audience decide? Because I'll tell you mine, I'm definitely on the side of telling the story and letting the audience decide from there. But, you know, what are some of those challenges and things that you wrestle with? Because that probably helps make decisions on what your final story says and what you're trying to push, but not trying to push it too far. Especially, I'm going to start with Denise, because obviously there was, you know, something that you wanted the audience to think about with that.
Right. I wanted to show the audience the lack of evidence. I wanted to show the audience lack of evidence based on physical evidence due to the dog's teeth not being able to have made the puncture wounds that were found on the injured dog. I wanted them to hear from a dog behaviorist as to the nature of the pit bull and how any dog can be raised to be aggressive, whether it's a pit bull, a chihuahua, a schnauzer, just based on how it's socialized. And I tried to get the judge, who was the one who ordered the dog to be euthanized, to be on camera and to tell her side of it, so we could get the other side of the story to be fair and objective in our film and not make it a tabloid or a propaganda piece. However, she declined, so we based it on the court records, the documentation of the hearing, and the sentencing that was handed down. But we wanted to avoid, I was an advocate, of course, for Tony and his family, but I didn't want the movie to look like I was trying to push my opinion on people that maybe had a different opinion, but hoping that my film would change their opinion once they saw it.
Thank you. Don, Bob?
Yeah, let me just say, when we first started, almost 10 years ago, there was a lot of naysayers around about our story. And so what we did first was to write the book, Mystery of the Trees, which was published in 2012. And then it's been printed twice and sold out twice. But Diane and I took that on the road and went out to 30, 35 lectures a year talking to people. And we put the evidence out there. But in the documentary, we put both sides. We wanted people to start out looking like, well, is this really true? Could this really be true? And we tried to put some people in there who had a little different opinion of it, and then eventually come with the elders who really had the real opinion, that's where the truth is, and put that whole thing out to kind of let people gather it all in and then make their own determination. And I think it works. People now, there's very few naysayers around anymore that we run into. They all have said, well, okay, we've got enough evidence out there to prove this.
But we do believe that there's a bit of an urgency to get the story out there. These trees are dying. The elders are dying. And this whole issue of, there are more Native Americans now in the United States than there were time Columbus came, or not Columbus, in the 1700s. When Columbus came, it's been estimated that 90% of them died of European diseases. So by the 1700s, it looked pretty sparse. But now there are more than there were then. And we kind of think of Indian things as in the past, but we're all sort of sitting here on ground that was judicial travesty in our history that is not in the books.
Going down alone, right?
Yeah, and also, in our film, if you look, if you saw it, it's dedicated to five people. Five of the people that we interviewed are dead since we started already. and they're going down fast. We got two more that are pretty close. So that's our, we need to get out, and we gotta get to it. We gotta raise the money to do it. And maybe a little sidebar on that. One of the interesting things that came out of that is when we wrote our book, we didn't know where we were gonna go with that. But we did write the book and put it out. We sold it, and that generated probably one third of the money to pay for the documentary. And we just took that money, Diane and I wrote it, but we didn't take any money out of it. We put it right straight into the documentary. So getting your book out first, tell the story, and get some interest going. We started getting interviewed by NPR and a number of other places, and that generated interest, and that got more money coming in.
And that's the real elephant in the room for documentaries.
I got some I'm gonna let Andre chime in on that, and I've got a little thing to wrap that up too, because you are correct. Funding, that is definitely something that probably deserves its own panel discussion just for nonfiction, but Andre, let me hear from you about propaganda versus let the audience decide.
Well, you know, I just grew up in a school where you let the story tell itself. You don't get it, you don't bother. You let people make that decision. I got one project I told you about, a couple of habits on an acting instructor. She was pretty rough on me. I took a class, I should know. And I never forget when she told me, she said, you'll never do lighting or anything in nature. When I got a lighting job, I saw her out in front and I said, you told me I would never do so-and-so, and I'm doing it, see, that's why I told you. So, you know, that being said, I realized that she had an orthodox way of teaching. But the way I look at it with her, your tree is one thing, your fruit is another. Her tree bears a lot of fruit. And there's a lot of trees out there in the forest, but you know, her tree has fruit on it. And maybe it was tough to climb her tree, but at the end of the day, she's got fruit on it. So when I do her story, I know people are gonna say some things about her that maybe some people say, wow. But I just want people to decide for themselves that, hey, look at what she accomplished and look what she put out there. And maybe she went through some crazy stuff herself, and that experience was translated over to some of us to make us hard enough to deal with this business we call entertainment, because this business is not a joke. We talked about it last panel, this is a serious, ugly business at times. It is, and you have to have real thick skin. So, you know, I'm from the school of let your documentary kind of tell its own story. You stay out of the way and not really make a decision about it, you know. So hopefully mine will just be a situation where people make their own decision. But my main project is based on education and history. And I think that's a big problem that we share. I know in my community, is history and education is just not always hand in hand. So that's how I'm approaching it.
Very good. And I think what I'll just say to that is, of course, you know, there's enough, just briefly we'll talk, say there's enough outlets out there to get funding for documentaries that will allow you to do that. Because there's obviously, you can, I think we're all smart people and we can tell what documentaries were funded by one side of the argument. And that's sort of where, you know, we'll leave that for a to be continued panel, hopefully that we'll do next year. But at this time, I'd like to open up the floor to anybody out there who has some questions for myself or any of the panelists. Let me go right here in front and I'll go right back to you. There you go.
Okay, my question is, when, as a documentary filmmaker, was your, whether it was on the projects you've been talking about, or maybe one of the past, maybe one of your first projects, that had a moment in it that was kind of your aha moment, like, this is really what I want to do because, just maybe because of the subject that you were working with, it affected them, or you felt that their story was so profound that you needed to educate people, or maybe afterwards when somebody maybe approached you or something happened where it was like, this made this whole film worth it because it changed somebody's way of thinking or somebody's life.
Yeah, I'll just say that we started finding these trees, as an example, back in 2003 and 2004, we put some of them up on our website. Found out that there were people throughout the nation that were doing the same thing. And so we gathered like-minded people at Hobbs State Park in Northwest Arkansas and
March of 2007. And we all compared notes, and it said, hey, you know, there's a bigger story here. And that if we're going to do something, we all have to start cooperating together to do it. And that's when it just really went. But it was not until then that we thought, well, gosh, there's more people. In the meantime, Bob had come up and looked at what we were doing and said to us, this is a story. You've got to get this going. And we said, look, we don't have any money. We don't have any experience in doing this. He said, I don't care. We're going to do it.
So we get a little teaser, a little short teaser that I got my narrator friend to do for freebie. And it really just kind of to raise the question to see if we could attract a little interest in the project. And that teaser then led them out on the road. And every time we would add a little segment, we'd add it to the road show. And people kept coming up and saying after the presentation, say, oh, we've got some of those trees in. I never heard of some of those trees. We'll send them in. So they take GPS readings, take photographs, send them in. There are over 2,000 now on the website in 40 states. And none of that was there to begin with. So there wasn't an aha so much as there was a continual growth.
And I know we might have some. Either of you two, and I know I would love to say something on that, but I want to make sure we just get the one question back there from Rob, and then we're going to have to wrap it up after that. But I think, are we all available afterwards to answer anyone's questions? Just I want to make sure we get at least one more question, and then we'll wrap it up.
I'm curious, with the 8-year production process, what was your post-production process? How did that change, and what types of software did you remain in one package and move to another?
Well, I can say that. I've been an Adobe user for a long time, so it was finished in Premiere Pro. And of course, you know how it's evolved. I wish I had the current version, the 2015 version. It'll do some things I wanted to do. Color grading is a royal pain. They have fixed it with 15, right? Made it easier in any rate. Yes. The technology over 8 years has really changed. You're talking, HDV was shot on DV film, DV tape. Those were tape cameras. And then when we did Dr. Jefferson with 4K and with a release in HD, that's like having a two-camera coverage, because you can cut around on what you shot. But play, the editing room for me is playing. I get to play with sound, pieces of sound, and pieces of visual, and try to make it make sense. But it was all done on a computer without any big post-production house.
Frame size is the final film?
I'm sorry?
Is it 1080 the final film?
Yeah, it's 1080.
Okay.
All right.
Well, on behalf of the Gwinnett Center International Film Festival, I want to thank all of you for joining us for the Documentary Filmmaker Roundtable, The Art of Nonfiction Filmmaking. I'd like to thank Andre, Don, Bob, and Denise. My name is Daniel Espeut. It's been an honor to sit up here and moderate for you folks. And I hope everyone enjoys the rest of the film festival, as well as the final panel discussion, which is director and screenwriter roundtable coming up very, very soon. So thank you so much, and have a wonderful, wonderful day.